In this video, I'm going to show you how to derive the tree-level Baba scattering cross-section from quantum electrodynamics. It's another classic quantum electrodynamics calculation that you often encounter in quantum field theory class, and it's of course very similar in form to the molar differential scattering cross-section calculation, which I did in my last video, and also because it involves antimatter, I have given essentially the same discussion of antimatter that I gave in the introduction in my perannihilation scattering cross-section calculation. So if you've seen those videos, and there are definitely some similarities, you can skip past. I still recommend watching the video because there's enough different for it to be interesting, but there are some commonalities that are probably worth it to just skip over because you've already seen them. The reason why I added them all in here is because I really want this video to be self-contained. I don't want anyone to have to go and watch separate videos just to understand this one. They should be able to watch just this one and understand it all. Anyway, it's a fun calculation. It's another pretty result. I think it's quite satisfying. So let's get going.
Let's begin with the math section for tree-level Baba scattering in quantum electrodynamics. As I said just a moment ago in the lab, we're going to calculate the tree-level scattering cross-section for Baba scattering. One could always expand on the tree-level with loops, but this is much more complicated. The tree-level result in calculations like this just reproduces the classical answer, despite the fact that we are using quantum field theory machinery to compute it. One only gets quantum corrections from perturbative quantum field theory if loops are included. The expansion in the number of loops is also an expansion in powers of Planck's constant, and therefore represents an expansion of the quantum corrections. Ignoring them, therefore, naturally just leave this with the classical result. In the case of Baba scattering, this division between classical and quantum is a subtle point because one usually hears of antimatter as a consequence of applying relativity to quantum mechanics. The resolution to this confusion is the following. In mechanics, this is how antimatter works. Antimatter is a consequence of applying relativity to quantum mechanics. But in field theory, things are slightly different. In field theory, the Dirac equation, Klein-Gordon equation, Rorita-Schwinger equation, etc., which play the role of relativistic quantum wave equations in mechanics, are reinterpreted as classical field equations, and then one incorporates quantum theory by quantizing the classical field and using the quantized field theory to calculate the effects of quantum fluctuations in the field. In field theory, therefore, antimatter is a relevant concept even at the classical level. At the tree level, we have these two Feynman diagrams for Baba scattering in quantum electrodynamics, where the solid lines are the fermion lines. Specifically, forward in time arrows represent electrons, and backwards in time arrows represent positrons. Including only the ones that are relevant at the tree level, the quantum electrodynamics Feynman rules are given here. There is a link in the description to a video where I show how to derive the complete set of Feynman rules for QED. Beyond these pictorial Feynman rules, there is one other important one that we must remember for this case, and that is that there is a relative minus sign generated by an interchange of fermion lines. This means that when we write out the Feynman amplitude terms corresponding to the two diagrams just given, we must make sure to have a relative minus sign. The calculation of the Baba scattering cross-section starts with this general differential scattering cross-section formula. There is a link in the description for a video where I show how to derive this general formula. This calculation will have several distinct stages. First, we will simplify the general differential scattering cross-section formula as much as we can without knowing the Feynman amplitude. Second, we will use the Feynman rules to write out the Feynman amplitude. Third, we will take the absolute square of the Feynman amplitude and then spend a lot of time simplifying it. Fourth, we will construct a parameterization for the momentum 4 vectors and insert it into the squared Feynman amplitude, and then write the cross-section. Lastly, we will take the ultra-relativistic and low-energy limits of the Baba scattering cross-section formula. Now, I avoid saying non-relativistic because this involves antimatter, which is innately a relativistic effect, so just avoiding the term to avoid confusion on details is a good idea. The center of mass reference frame will be assumed for this calculation. This fact is used to simplify things throughout the calculation. Towards the end, a specific parameterization based on this reference frame is adopted and used to obtain the final answer. This is the parameterization that I mentioned in the last paragraph. The first thing we will do in this section is insert the momentum variables written in the Feynman diagrams into the differential scattering cross-section. We can see from the diagrams that we only have two outgoing particles, so the immediate result of this will be simpler than the starting point. Beyond this, the standard result also includes averaging over the incoming fermion spins and summing over the outgoing fermion spins, so we will need to insert those averages/sums on the absolute absolute squared Feynman amplitude into the differential scattering cross section. Doing all of this in the formula given in the introduction easily gives us this. You may notice that I added a 6 superscript to the differential on sigma. This is to indicate how many differentials there are on the other side of the equation. This number will drop as we complete phase space integrations over some of the momentum and energy variables. The standard Baba differential scattering cross section is with respect to the solid angle of the outgoing electron. Therefore, one of the things that we will need to do in preparing the differential scattering cross-section formula is integrate over the other momentum variables. It turns out that this can be done before we have worked out the Feynman amplitude because of the Dirac delta functions that show up in the cross-section formula. They are there to impose energy and momentum conservation. Therefore, we can do the necessary phase space integration without knowing the Feynman amplitude as long as we take the energy and momentum conservation relations to be true for the Feynman amplitude, which depends on those variables. It turns out that these relations are extremely useful in simplifying the absolute square of the Feynman amplitude. I chose to integrate over P2 to begin with. This is the first step in getting the differential scattering cross-section with respect to the solid angle of the electron. Because of the momentum conservation delta function, integration simply yields this result, where the delta function has enforced this mechanical momentum conservation relation. The next step is to put the remaining differential in spherical coordinates. This is necessary because it explicitly reveals the solid angle differential that we want to write the differential scattering cross-section with respect to. Doing that gives us this. Therefore, the final integration that we must perform to get the differential scattering cross-section with respect to the desired solid angle is this one, where we have these two formulas for the energies as a function of the variables we're actually integrating with respect to. These are not functions of the variable that we're integrating with respect to. Now, this relation here comes from the fact that we're in the center of mass frame. We can use the standard identity for rewriting the delta function here to rewrite it like this, where f prime is the derivative of this function here, and p1 prime magnitude naught is the root of the f function, or the real value of p1 prime magnitude, the one that satisfies energy conservation. Because of the delta function, we have this relation imposed, which through that imposes this energy conservation relation. We can then relabel the actual momentum, this one, with the symbol we just used for the integration variable. Because we finished the integration, it gives us this result, and we can simplify the notation by doing that. F prime works out to be this. It is worth pointing out that the superscript on the differential is usually dropped. It was useful to keep track of things while we were doing the integration, but it is no longer needed, so we'll drop it. Therefore, we can write this. Keep in mind that because of the integrations that we did, d sigma doesn't mean quite what it did in the general formula at the beginning, where we had d sigma equals a formula with however many differentials we needed to account for all the momentum variables. None of them had been integrated over yet. If we insert this f prime function, the differential scattering cross-section becomes this ultimately, because we've got that nice cancellation. By applying energy conservation that was mandated by the last delta function, we can replace this quantity with this one, which gets us to that. Because we're assuming the center of mass frame, we can then rewrite this quantity like that, which finally gets us here. This will be simplified further when we apply it after we've calculated this Feynman amplitude squared quantity. This completes the pre-simplification of the differential scattering cross-section. Now we must begin actually trying to handle the Feynman amplitude. The next step is to use Feynman's rules to write out the Feynman amplitude. The first diagram gives this term right here via the Feynman rules, and the second diagram gives this one, so the full Feynman amplitude for the tree level here is just the sum of the two. Now remember, we inserted that relative minus sign because of the interchange of external fermions differing the two Feynman diagrams. Of course, taking the absolute square of a quantity entails multiplying it by its complex conjugate. This raises a slight complication here because that means that we must complex conjugate a complicated product of matrices. Luckily, there's an easy identity for that. This identity consists of complex conjugating the prefactor, flipping the spinners, and reversing the order of the matrices sandwiched in between. Now, because there's only one matrix, there's not really much of an order to reverse, so we just get these results for the complex conjugated terms in the Feynman amplitude. The square we want to calculate is this. We'll handle each of these four terms separately. We see two of them are of the form of the modulus squared of the Feynman amplitude contributing terms, and two are cross terms. Let's handle the first one that's of the type of the modulus squared of one of the Feynman amplitude contributing terms. Plugging in the relevant factors gets us to here. We can then do some index index juggling to get rid of the metric tensors, and we can pull out some factors to the front that we don't need under the sum. Next, we can rearrange scalar factors in preparation to use these identities. Then we can strategically take traces of scalar factors in here in order to use the cyclic property of the trace such that we can get rid of all the spinners with these factors here that we have. Inserting them gets us to this. Now we can handle the other one that's of the form of the modulus squared of one of the contributing Feynman amplitude terms. If we insert the relevant factors, that gives us this. Then we can do the same process we did before of pulling factors out to the front that don't need to be in there, doing some index juggling, and then moving scalar factors around as needed to apply these identities later. Then we can add traces in to use the cyclic property of the trace such that these can be used to replace all of the spinners. Specifically, the cyclic property allows us to move this over there and this over there, so that then by inserting these results we can get to here. Next, we can do the same thing to the first cross term. Doing that gives us a result of a slightly different form. We get a single trace factor instead of two contracted trace factors like we get up here, and it has many more factors in it. Then we can handle the other cross term in exactly the same way as we handled the first cross term, and again we get another one of this form. Then we can plug them all back into the complete squared Feynman amplitude and get this formula for it. Now if we break that down into the individual traces so that we can evaluate the traces separately, we get something that looks like this, where I've just made some definitions to make it easier to keep track of the different pieces we're working with. Let's handle the first trace here. The first thing we can do in simplifying T1 mu nu down is we can factor out these two m's from the denominator. Then we can multiply it out and realize that traces of products of odd numbers of gamma matrices gives us zeros, so we just arrive at this. Then we can use ordinary gamma matrix identities to evaluate these traces. This one just gives the metric tensor when you take its trace, and then we can use this identity to evaluate this trace of four matrices. That ultimately gives us this. Now we can handle T2. The process is the same. We can pull those denominators out, multiply it out, ignore terms with products of odd numbers of gamma matrices because they trace to zero, and then use standard gamma matrix identities to evaluate the remaining gamma matrix traces, ultimately giving us this result. Then we know that we have this quantity as the actual numerator of the first term, and since we've just calculated those two traces, we can now contract them. Multiplying that out gives us this. Writing it in dot product notation gets us here, and simplifying gets us here. Then we have the four momentum conservation relation, which comes from mechanical momentum conservation combined with energy conservation put into four vector form. We can square both sides of this and simplify to get that one, and then we can rearrange this in two different ways and square and simplify to get these two, and they help us simplify this directly down to that. Then we can use four momentum conservation directly to simplify the last two terms there down to this, which gives us this final answer for this contracted product of T1 and T2. Then we can handle a more complicated one, the first of the cross-term traces that we will have handled, and that is T3. The process is the same, even if it is more complicated. We pull out the denominators there, then we multiply it out, and we remember that traces of products of odd numbers of gamma matrices are zero, which simplifies it down to here. Then we can write this as a sum of terms proportional to traces and label all the traces so that then we can calculate them separately. This whole section is dedicated to calculating traces that show up in the squared Feynman amplitude separately so that we can then substitute them back in later. Now, I've shown you in this table here how to calculate each one of the ones that showed up in that box, these, and their evaluation makes use of all of these gamma matrix identities there. If we insert those results into T3, we get to this, and we can simplify it down to that. Then applying these same relations that I talked about earlier allows us to get down to here. Then we can further simplify it by remembering that we're in the center of mass frame. We can ultimately work it all the way down to this. Now let's handle the second cross-term trace. It's another long one. Pulling out the denominator gets us to here. Then we can multiply that out, ignore terms with products of odd numbers of gamma matrices, which trace to zero, then write it as a sum of terms proportional to traces, give labels to those traces, and then calculate them separately with the same identities that we used for the last such table of traces. Plugging the results back in get us to this. We can simplify a little bit down to this. Then with the help of these identities, we can process it down to that result here. Now we can calculate T5, pull out the denominators, multiply things out, ignore terms with odd numbers of gamma matrices in them because they trace to zero, and then use standard gamma matrix identities to evaluate it, and we get that. T6, of course, proceeds in exactly the same way I've written it out. So if you want to see the process work through yet again, you can. Then we can contract T5 and T6 to get the numerator for the fourth term that we want. Multiplying things out gets us to here, and then writing it in dot product notation gets us to there, and then simplifying we get to here, and we can apply these relations again, which gets us down to there. Then we can use 4 momentum conservation to simplify the last two terms, and ultimately arrive at this result. Inserting all these traces back into the Feynman amplitude square gets us to here. We see that we can combine these two terms there, so we have the result for this section right here. With the Feynman amplitude square now written in terms of 4 momentum dot products, we are ready to finish the calculation by selecting a parameterization for the 4 momentum vectors based on the center of mass frame. Figure 1 illustrates the center of mass frame and also indicates what the angle theta in the parameterization we will be using corresponds to physically. Based on the concept of the center of mass frame and this definition for the angle theta, we arrive at this standard center of mass frame parameterization for the momentum vectors. We can then evaluate all the momentum-dependent quantities that show up in the Feynman amplitude square and the cross-section formula in terms of this new parameterization. We get these results for dot products and magnitudes, then we get these results for the various quadratic and the momentum quantities that show up in the denominators. We can then insert these into the center of mass frame differential scattering cross-section. At this point, we can recognize that these two masses are actually equal because they're antiparticles of each other, and if the masses are equal and we're in the center of mass frame, then the energies have to be equal. E1 plus E2 just becomes 2E, and we can also plug in these values for the magnitudes of the momentum vectors, and that gets us ultimately to here, rewriting things in terms of the fine structure constant as well. We can also insert these various quantities written in terms of the parameterization into the Feynman amplitude square, which gets us this messy result. If we do some obvious simplification in this last term there, we get down to here. Unlike problems like molar scattering, the Baba tree-level Feynman amplitude square doesn't simplify down very nicely for the general case. The above is about as simple as it gets, so plugging that into the differential scattering cross-section gives this final answer for the general case anyway. While for the general case this doesn't simplify down very nicely, it does simplify down very nicely in the ultra-relativistic limit and the low-energy limit. Let's start by taking the ultra-relativistic limit. This is the limit, of course, where mass goes to zero, and this messy result simplifies down to this one immediately when we set mass equal to zero. We can then simplify it further to get here, and then we can use these identities to get the standard result for the Feynman amplitude squared, and then we can plug it into the differential scattering cross-section formula, and that gives us this result for the standard Baba differential scattering cross-section formula in the ultra-relativistic limit. I think it's really quite beautiful, and it's certainly the most famous differential scattering cross-section associated with Baba scattering. Usually when you see it calculated in quantum field theory classes, it's this result that they go for, as opposed to the general result or even the low energy limit, which is also less common. In the low energy limit, where the energy goes to the mass, so the momentum is going to zero, the denominators of the first two terms go to zero, while the denominator of the third does not. This means that the first two terms tend towards infinity, while the third stays finite. This means we can neglect the third term, which gets us to here. And then we can factor out one of these factors that cause the first two terms to diverge from both denominators. It's just equal to negative p squared, which of course is going to zero as p goes to zero, which is the same thing as e going to m. This leaves us with this formula there. Now if we consider this one in the limit as the energy goes to the mass, then this one no longer diverges because we've factored that out. This one still does though, although not as much. But that means that we can neglect this one, which gets us down to here. Now in terms of this expression here, what we just did simply reflects that while both diverge, this one diverges a lot faster, so we can neglect the second term as well as the third one. We can then pull out another one of those divergent factors, which gives us a factor of p to the fourth right there. Then we can apply this same limit to the numerator. Taking that limit on the numerator gets us down to here, which is much simpler. We can then apply this trig identity, which gets us here. Then we can remember that p equals mv in the low energy limit, which gets us to this result. Then we can plug that into the differential scattering cross-section formula, which ultimately gets us this gorgeous result here. So this is the Baba differential scattering cross-section in the low energy limit. And that completes our analysis of Baba scattering. Thanks for listening.
So now you know how to use the Feynman rules of quantum electrodynamics and the standard differential scattering cross-section general formula to calculate the tree-level differential scattering cross-section for Baba scattering. We handled the general case first, and then we took the ultra-relativistic and low-energy limits of that general result to get the more famous and rather more elegant cross-section results for those cases. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please give it a thumbs up and consider subscribing. Dietrich out.